We are really excited to be in full practice. Obviously, you have your off-season hours that I feel like were really productive for us. But for this team, I was really counting down the days till we could get to 20 hours a week. I think that's been really important for our team. So I like the way we've started. I like their energy, their commitment. I like their communication. Although we're continuing to work in every area to get better, I like where we're starting. And, just excited about where we can go. We have a few that are a little banged up today. Edie, Darby, Avery, Strickland, and Tamari Key. So at this point, you're going to usually see some that are out, in and out of practice, and we should be able to get them back in pretty quickly. Tamari's an unusual case, obviously, since she didn't play at all last year. We're just trying to be mindful of her body as she gets back into playing, and you know, just try to be patient and allow her to you know, help guide us with how she's feeling.
Obviously, everybody wants to see the old Tamari, but how hard is it to kind of temper the expectations of what you can expect for her as you try to ramp her up?
Yeah, I think it's really important that we understand she's not going to just snap her fingers and be like she was. And, you know, you have to, you know, look at it in a different lens. She had to sit out and do nothing for a long time, and so now we're just trying to be as smart as we can to be able to put her in a position to be successful, but also to be healthy as she continues her career.
How do you as a coaching staff handle that? Was that a moment where you lean heavily into what she's telling you?
Well, our athletic trainers, our physicians, our dietitian, our strength coach, it's a team effort, and obviously they're guiding me, but we're in constant communication with that group of people, but also with Tamari, because she's the one that has to give us the feedback.
We talked to her a little bit about how she's grown off the court in terms of a leader and helping the younger girls, but what have you seen from her?
Yeah, I think she, as she continues to go through her career, I think you see her mature, not just as a young woman, but as a basketball player. I think the way that she was able to look at the court and look at the team and look at the game and practices in a different light last year, I think was really good for her growth and development. I think she learned a lot while she was sitting out, and I think she also understands the role that she can have for this team in terms of being a leader.
What do you remember as a player facing these Team USA teams?
Yes. So my very first opportunity to put on a jersey was against Team USA, and it was the Dream Team, the 96 Dream Team. I got in the game. I do remember I was holding the basketball. I was looking for someone to throw it to because I was going to pass it to the post because Pat told me to pass it to the post. I'm a rule follower, so I'm ready to pass it to the post, and Nikki McCray took the ball and went and shot a layup. And so that was literally my first experience in an orange jersey, or orange and white jersey, I guess I should say. Very competitive. You're playing the best in the world. And you know, it was a fun experience to be able to do that.
Have you talked with the team yet about kind of what to expect?
We only spoke with them briefly about the game itself, and we just talked to them about playing the best in the world and playing grown women. And you know, I think it's we've had some players that have experienced USA basketball, and I think those experiences are going to be able to, those are experiences we're going to draw off of. We're going to be able to share with the team.
What do you
get out of that game? Because I assume you're not doing a ton of scouting on Team USA, just from an opponent's standpoint. You know, what do you hope that your team gets out of that matchup?
Well, I think the competition, first and foremost. I think the excitement. It's a great opportunity to get to play a team that hopefully will be competing for a gold medal. And, you know, I think it's we're also doing this for Team USA, right? We want to help give them opportunities in front of a lot of fans to be able to support them. So to me, it's helping everyone. It's growing our game. It's giving our players an opportunity to play the best and hopefully supporting them while we're doing it.
How does scheduling that game go about to have Team USA want to play you all here?
Yeah, to be quite honest with you, USA Basketball contacted us, and you know, that's them. I'm like, yes, that's great, and then we pass it along. So our administration's able to work with the folks from USA Basketball. I know there's a lot that goes into it behind the scenes, and I just thank our administration for making it happen, for allowing us to have that opportunity.
It's a very, very home-heavy, non-conference portion of your schedule. I think you only go on the road once before SEC play. How much of a challenge is that, not having that hostile environment before you get into league play?
Yeah, I think for this particular team, I think we're going to be okay. We've experienced that. Our newcomers are all veterans. They've all played college basketball. So I think this team can handle it, you know, and they have to figure it out. They have to handle it pretty quickly. But, you know, scheduling is it's tough every year. I mean, just trying to – you have a wish list. I mean, we have a wonderful wish list. And then you've got a lot of things you have to work through. So we're excited about the schedule and the opportunity that we have, and hopefully it will prepare us.
What is Cooper's role this year since she's not able to play?
Yeah, so Talaysia has been filling in a lot of areas in practice. Sometimes, depending on our folks in and out of practice, she makes number 10 with the team. Sometimes she gets to go over and play with our scout team. I think she likes those days a little better, to be honest with you. No coaching, she gets to play a little freer. But she's learning. I think the biggest thing for her is helping make everyone else better, learn our system, really work hard in the weight room, get stronger, and really be prepared to go next year.
What are some things y'all are doing as a coaching staff with the new transfers to kind of avoid that slow start to have the team gel earlier this season?
Yeah, we've done we did a lot of team building last year, off the court, a lot of work off the court. This year we're probably doing more on the court work, doing a lot more 5-on-5 early in the season, in our practices. I think going to Europe was so important. It was great for our team to play together and learn together and be together. We still have we'll have a closed scrimmage that will incorporate a retreat, so we'll still do some off the court things, but I've modified my practices to get them in 5-on-5 situations a little bit earlier.
Referenced Avery and Edie, are they injuries, and when do you expect them back?
Yeah, they're day-to-day. I don't think I'll have either of them today, but there's a chance that one might pop back up. But we're expecting after fall break to get them both back into practice.
Do you have like a timetable on Tamari's like minutes, what you'd like to see?
No, I think right now, I really think that's there are too many unknowns for us to even put a timetable on it at this point. I think we've got another couple of weeks to go, and then maybe we can start putting some time frames on some things. But right now, we're just listening to her and listening to our trainers and doctors and trying to do what's best for her.
All right, with Tamari coming back, what do you expect Jillian's role to look like this year?
Jillian's had a good summer and fall season. I think she's still going to play the 4 and the 5 for us. You know, if Tamari gives us minutes, then Jillian can slide over to the 4 and give us some perimeter skill set with some size. But Jillian can play that center spot, and then we've got Rakia and Sarah that can be in that 4 position as well. So, you know, I think Jillian's versatility has been good, but also she's a go-to player, and I think having a go-to player that we can count on, that's consistent, like she's been, is really important.
I know it's probably not really on your mind this early, but the transfer portal changing from 60 days to 45 days yesterday, does that change at all? Do you think that will change your strategy attacking the portal moving forward?
No, I don't think it will change things. You know, the shorter window, it just – you just get to it a little quicker. I think your strategy is going to be the same. The players still have a long time. They can decide at any point. They just have to know they're transferring within those 40 days. So that's the easy part. The hard part is then going and recruiting them and getting them after they go in the portal.
How do you feel, you guys, because I think it's like year five now, the portal, like, where do you feel you are just understanding it, and how comfortable are you with what you guys have implemented in your strategy of it?
Yeah, I think we've been successful, and I think what we've done is really taken the portal to be able to fill in the gaps that we need, and we still have four-year players that are, you know, consistent culture builders. They're there. It's a different feel, and I think the pieces have been fitting. I think when we bring in people, it has to make sense. The one thing about the recruiting portal, that's what it feels like, the transfer portal, it is rapid. The movement is so fast. The recruiting process out of the portal is lightning speed, and so that's something that we've learned and adjusted to. Lift it, lift it, lift it.